Well, good evening. I hope you got your nap in today, because I did. I finally got me a nap. Still made it to choir practice on time. But, good to see you back tonight. Let's worship the Lord tonight.
I once was sad and lonely, I felt so all alone, until I asked the Lord to take control. He gave to me an answer and said that I was free. He cleansed my heart and then he cleansed my soul. I know I'm saved.
Shake hands with one another. Welcome each other back to church tonight.
Amen. Good evening. Good evening. Good to see everyone in church tonight. Thank you for being here and for being faithful to the house of the Lord tonight. I'll mention some prayer requests here in just a little while, and I'll update you in regards to a couple of folks that are unable to be with us tonight, and we want to be much in prayer for them. Let me just remind you of some upcoming events. We will have our men's prayer time on Tuesday morning at 11, our Wednesday morning Bible study at 11, Wednesday evening service at 6, and this Wednesday is rock night, so please bring drinks, desserts, and chips for rock night this week. The Matthews family will be here with us this coming Sunday. They'll be here July the 16th. At 10:45 a.m. How many of you know the Matthews family or the Rochester family, what they used to be, the Rochesters? They will be here with us, and I know that you'll enjoy hearing these folks all the way from Blacksburg, South Carolina, all the way from just over the hill, as it would be. And we will have a meal following the service in the Family Life Center, so this will be a good time of food and fellowship. Certainly looking forward to that. On Saturday, July the 22nd, which is just around the corner, it's 2 weeks from yesterday, that's difficult for me to begin to wrap my brain around the fact that we're already talking about events that are going to be at the end of July, but we are having a kids' fun day here from 4 until 6:30 p.m. on that Saturday. There are some flyers in the foyer. There were some in your bulletins this morning. Help us get the word out to folks about this event. Bring your children, your grandchildren, your nieces and nephews. Bring them with you. Invite children to come out. And Jacob and I were talking about it earlier today that he said, so basically it's going to be like a one-day VBS where we'll have a Bible story time. We'll have some food and some games, and that's a great way to look at it as far as what we're going to do and how we're going to minister to children here in the community. But bring your kids, your grandkids, nieces, nephews. You see children just walking on the side of the road, hand them a flyer and invite them to come. What was that? No, I didn't say pick them up. Okay. That'll get you in trouble, so let's not do that. So anyway, we want to have a really good day on that day and minister again to those children in the community. Looking forward to what the Lord's going to do for us in the service tonight. You be much in prayer. Brother Chris is coming right now as we stand to our feet and worship the Lord in song. Brother Chris.
189. I have found a friend in Jesus, he's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me and Satan tempts me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall feed. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roam. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. As we do pretty well at every service, I do want you to continue to pray for Miss Debbie Parker, asking for the Lord's hand to touch her, to help her feel better with all that she is enduring right now. Please keep Karen and Eddie Ricker in your prayers, as well as Ms. Catherine Fannin with an upcoming surgery on Tuesday, August the 1st. Keep Ms. Joanne Wiley in your prayers. As I've stated often, she has a long road of recovery to really get back to where she was or where she needs to be. Please keep John Geiser's father, Peter Geiser, in your prayers. I know that I've stated this several times of late, but it truly is just a matter of time with John's father and with all that's going on with a very rapidly growing brain tumor. Please pray for John and his mother as they're taking care of his father right now as well. Keep Miss Phyllis Gillespie in your prayers. Miss Phyllis will have a nuclear stress test on Thursday. She's having several different health issues here and there, and we want to pray for her. And I know that she's a little bit nervous about this nuclear stress test on Thursday, so let's remember her. Miss Sylvia Davis is not with us tonight, as she's going to be having a sleep study. And as she mentioned that to me this morning at the end of the service, she told me that she was going to have to be doing that. And I said to her that they just need to go ahead and come on here, because I cure insomnia every time that I preach. So, you know, anybody that needs to have a sleep study can do it in the comfort of our sanctuary. No, please be much in prayer for Miss Sylvia. And again, asking for the Lord's hand to be upon her. A number of different items have been mentioned of late, kind of in passing, in talking about burdens and concerns and again, even some tragedies that have occurred. I know that Brother Chris and Miss Renee happened upon one yesterday on the east side of Gaffney as they were coming home, a motorcycle accident that resulted in a fatality. Just a number of things that have happened even close by here, things that are occurring in our community, in our county, and we want to continue to pray for all of these. Any special spoken objects of prayer that are on your hearts tonight? Miss Lou. Amen. Amen. Miss Lou had spent some time in the hospital on Monday and Tuesday and got to come home on Wednesday, and praise the Lord that she's feeling better and is here both this morning and tonight. Brother Tom.
Christine Hyder seems to be more and more confused.
Yes, sir.
I don't think to keep her in prayer.
Let's continue to pray for Miss Christine Hyder tonight. And truly, I have witnessed, whether it's face-to-face or on the phone, a great amount of confusion with her. So please, please pray for her. Anyone else? Special spoken objects of prayer tonight. I am confident that we all have unspoken objects that we would mention maybe just by raising our hands tonight. The Lord knows what's on our hearts. And I know that we do this sort of thing on Wednesday evenings, but I feel led of the Lord tonight for us to have an altar of prayer tonight. If you would, if you are comfortable, if you're physically able and would like to, I want to invite you to the altars this evening as we go to the Lord in prayer. So if you'd come at this time. And as you're making your way to the front, Brother Bobby Merck, if you would come to the pulpit and lead us to the Lord in prayer tonight.
Wait till everybody gets up here. We thank you, dear Lord, for bringing us back to church tonight to worship you again, dear Lord. We thank you for the service we had this morning. I hope everybody got a lot out of it. I know I did, and it was something I needed to hear. I ask you to be with our service tonight. Just put on Pastor Jody's heart what we need to hear. Let us use it to become better Christians and better people. We ask you to be with, give us a safe travel home and then be with us through the next few days and bring us back to church again Wednesday morning for Bible study and Wednesday night prayer meeting. We thank you, dear Lord, for everything that you've done for us, and we thank you for everything that you're going to do. We pray that you just keep your hands on this church and keep your hands on Pastor Jody as he continues to lead and guide us in the right direction. We thank you, dear Lord, once again for everything that you've done for us and everything you're going to do. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Right, as you make your way back to your pew, if you would grab a hymnal, let's turn to 140. 140 will be our offertory. 140, first, second, and last.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart not apply. Glory to His name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood of. Glory to His name.
Brother Bobby, you ask a blessing on the offering.
Dear Lord, we thank You once again for bringing us back to church to worship You. Just lay on Pastor Jody's heart all we need to hear. We ask You to bless these tithes and offerings and let them be used to upbuild Your kingdom. We thank You, ask in Your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Miss Betty Jill. Thank you for ministering to our hearts, and I appreciate our musicians here and what they do for us and how that they handle things so beautifully on the instruments. I know that I say this occasionally, but I don't say it nearly enough. We are blessed with good musicians here that serve the Lord and that want to be a blessing to us. So again, whether it's those that play the instruments or Brother Chris as he leads the music or those that do special music for us, we are blessed. And I wanted to say a thank you to everyone tonight. Take your Bibles, turn with me this evening, if you would, in the New Testament to the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 13. And we're going to begin tonight in verse number 11. If you have picked up a study guide for tonight, you'll notice that there aren't places for you to fill in any blanks. There aren't things necessarily to follow by way of a traditional outline, as I often do, because we're just going to quote my mentor once again, we're going to persecute one verse and flee to the next tonight as we just keep rolling through Revelation chapter 13. Last Sunday evening, we began looking at this wonderful and marvelous chapter of the Word of God. As we studied, we learned about the beast from the sea. We saw details concerning his power and his abilities, but I need to just be very quick to say to you again tonight. In all actuality, the beast, the Antichrist, and the false prophet, even Satan himself, they do not have power as much as they have permission. Sometimes we get the idea, and it is a wrong one, and I need to start doing a better job in dispelling things that are false doctrine while also proclaiming what is true doctrine. Sometimes we have given off the concept, even in our churches, that God and Satan are opposite equals. Listen to me carefully. They are not equals. While they may be opposites, they are not equals. Satan is a created being. God is. He always has been and he always will be. God is. And so when you begin to look at what's going on in Scripture, we need to understand that Satan has permission to do certain things. And in Revelation 16, in Revelation 19, and again in Revelation 20, the beast from the earth is called the false prophet. So that's something to keep in mind as we begin to dive into this tonight. Again, in Revelation 16, Revelation 19, even Revelation chapter 20, the beast from the earth is called the false prophet. The dragon, or Satan, is the counterfeit God the Father. He, again, would like to have that position that belongs only to God, but Satan is the counterfeit father, the beast is the counterfeit Christ, and the false prophet is the counterfeit Holy Spirit. So begin to kind of get that order in your mind or that understanding, and I'll do that once more. Satan is the counterfeit father, the beast is the counterfeit Christ, and the false prophet is the counterfeit Holy Spirit. But this is where I need to stop for a minute. And I need to say to you that Satan has always loved trying to counterfeit what God has made as a genuine article. Satan has loved doing that sort of thing. And he excels at it in that he offers people temporary happiness. And I don't even really like using the word happiness. He offers people temporary excitement, temporary fun. The biblical word for me to use right now would be that he offers temporary pleasure. And I'm going to say something that you probably will rarely hear a pastor say from the pulpit. Did you know that there is pleasure in sin? There is pleasure in sin. And yes, thankfully, some of you are already stating it back to me for a season. For a season. And Satan loves to offer people something that is counterfeit. And one of the things that he does is he offers pleasure in sin for a season. Well, lest I go chasing too many thoughts tonight, let me return to Revelation 13 and talk to you once again about this satanic trinity, the beast, the false prophet, the Antichrist, all of those completing the satanic trinity. In Revelation 13, we're going to start at verse number 11 tonight. Follow along with me where the Word of God says, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed." Boy, a lot of interesting words and phrases in Revelation 13, 11, and 12. But I'm going to, again, kind of come at this from a different angle. One of the ministries of the Holy Spirit is to glorify Christ and to lead people to trust and worship Him. That's one of the ministries of the Holy Spirit, In fact, when we study from the Gospel according to John, we find that Jesus is even talking about the Comforter and what He will do when He comes, and how the Holy Ghost came on the day of Pentecost and now takes up residence within the heart and life of every believer. That happens at the moment of salvation. The Holy Spirit comes into your life to live and to help you grow, to help you follow what the Word of God has to say. That's the Holy Spirit's work in your life. He glorifies Christ. In fact, Jesus said that the Holy Ghost would not speak of Himself, but that He would speak of Jesus, would speak of me, Jesus said. So again, I've got to lay the groundwork right now in explaining to you that one of the ministries of the Holy Spirit is to glorify Christ, to lead people to trust and worship Him. But the false prophet, if he is the satanic counterpart to the Holy Ghost, the false prophet will point to the Antichrist and to his image and compel people to worship Satan through the beast. If you look at something that's being said in Revelation 13, verses 11 and 12, you find that there is an image of horns upon this particular beast, and it suggests that the false prophet has authority. But again, in keeping with some of what we discovered and discussed last Sunday night, the absence of a crown indicates that his authority is not political. In Matthew 24, Jesus warned that there would be false prophets. And this one will certainly be the greatest. He will have the character. Check this out, and some of you might want to jot this down in your notes tonight. He will have the character of a lamb. Did you see that? And he had two horns like a lamb. But check this out tonight. Even though he may have the character of a lamb, he will have the voice of a dragon. He may look like one thing, but he will speak like something else. What a deceiver he will be. And the world will listen to him. Hey, look up. Listen up. I say this to you again tonight, and I'm not trying to frighten anybody, but if I could scare you into realizing your need for Jesus, I would. In fact, years ago, we used to preach and teach a great deal about hell, and people would be fearful of hell, and the Holy Spirit would use that to convict them and show them their need of a Savior. I need you to understand something tonight. There exists within our world such a sentiment and such an attitude that just as soon as the Antichrist comes on the scene, the world will listen to him. It exists right now. I have stated this for years now, that the stage is set, the table is ready for one person to step on the scene and say, "I have all the answers. Just follow me. Pledge your allegiance to me. Bow down to me. I will solve the problem of the crisis in the Middle East. I will solve the problem of the energy crisis. I will solve the problem of this and that and something else if you'll just follow me." Again, the frightening thing is that the world will listen when this deceiver begins to speak. When Jesus walked upon the earth and ministered here, Jewish leaders often asked him to perform some sign, some miracle, to prove that he was indeed their Messiah. Boy, they asked him to do that often. "Give us a sign and we will believe." Of course, Jesus responded and said, "A foolish and an adulterous generation seeketh after a sign." So, Christian, please hear me on something tonight. to look at God, to say to God that you have to have some sort of sign in the heavens or you have to have some sort of miraculous experience in order to follow Him or believe in Him, you are just putting yourself in the category of a foolish and adulterous generation. But we have all that we need. We've got the Word of God. We can look within it. We have the Spirit of God who is our teacher and our God. We don't have to have supernatural signs in the heavens. Religious leaders, the Jewish members of the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, they said to Jesus, "Give us a sign and we will believe. Give us a sign in the heavens and we will believe." Let me point this out to you, and I have done this before, but when Jesus was born, He put a new star in the sky. Well, Larry, when He died, He put out the sun. The sun turned black for 3 hours. What more signs in the heavens do you need? He even gave them what they were looking for, and still they did not believe. When you look at what's being said, when you realize that Jesus was asked to do this, but the false prophet, he will perform deceptive signs that will lead the world into devil worship. And Christian, I need to say to you lovingly tonight that we are very, very close to that sort of thing going on in our world today. And I'm not going to go into any details. I'm not going to put images up on the monitors behind me. But all you have to do is go back and see what happened at the Grammy Awards this year to see that we are real close to worldwide Satan worship. Oh, Pastor, that was just a performance. No, that shows what's in people's hearts today. His greatest sign will be something entitled "The Abomination of Desolation." And many of you, again, may want to just jot that down in your notes tonight. His greatest sign will be the abomination of desolation, mentioned by Daniel. Daniel mentions it in Daniel 9:27, Daniel 11:36. Jesus mentioned it in Matthew 24:15, and Paul even spoke about it in 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 4. His greatest sign will be the abomination of desolation. Now, I use that phrase, and many of you are just kind of hurriedly writing that down, and now the question comes, what is the abomination of desolation? It is the image of the beast being set up in the temple in Jerusalem. You say, well, Pastor, that doesn't sound too bad. That's not that big of a deal to set up the image of the beast in the temple in Jerusalem. We're going to talk about that. An idol is bad enough. And by the way, has God ever ruled on this issue of not having any idols? Sure He has, in the Ten Commandments. An idol is bad enough, but setting it up in the temple is the height of all blasphemy. Let me try to explain it in a way that, again, makes sense to me in what would go on. Imagine with me that our sanctuary here at Rock Springs is the temple in Jerusalem. And frankly, I need to again point out the fact that there is not one there currently. The temple's been destroyed. It will be rebuilt one day. But imagine with me for a minute that our sanctuary depicts, or again is a picture of, the temple in Jerusalem. What would it be like if when you arrived to church next Sunday, the communion table is gone, the pulpit is gone, and an image, an idol of someone is up here? And I'm not going to be here if that happens, but nevertheless, an image or an idol of someone is up here, and you are compelled to come and bow down before it. In the house of God, in the sanctuary as it would be. Would that appear blasphemous to you? Sure it would. That's exactly the same type of picture that I need you to see that will one day happen in the temple. Since Satan has wanted and even desired to have worship in heaven, but he could not command worship of himself in heaven, he will go to the next best place. He'll go to the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. He'll use that structure as the place where he will receive worship and have people bow down to him. Look at Revelation 13, verses 13 through 15 with me now. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. Boy, I got to tell you, you read those verses, that's an interesting set of miracles that will occur. The false prophet, energized by Satan, will perform his great wonders. That's what's being discussed in these verses. He will even duplicate some of the signs that had been performed by the two witnesses. Do you remember those two witnesses that we discussed all the way back in Revelation 11? He'll even duplicate some of the signs performed by them. Up to this time, the two witnesses have been ministering at the temple in Jerusalem, but the beast will slay them and even take over the temple. Going back a little bit in our study, when God raises the two witnesses from the dead and takes them to heaven, the false prophet will answer that challenge by giving life to the image of the beast. And I do all that on purpose tonight. Again, imagine this idol that's been set up, this image that has been set up. And Brother Chris, the false prophet is going to cause it to come to life. You talk about astounding the world and causing people to wonder at it all. Not only will the image move, but it will speak. In Revelation 13, verses 16 and 17, we read, "And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name." Not content to simply control people through religious deceit, the false prophet will now institute some strong economic measures as well. Everyone except believers will receive a special mark in order to buy or sell. But the only way to get that mark, did you see it in the verses that I read to you? The only way to get that mark is to submit to the beast and to worship him. So again, I need everybody to look up, listen up, and let me talk to you about a few things. And I want to be careful, and I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but I love the way that it has even been explained and described that Noah was a conspiracy theorist until it started raining. So I'm not a conspiracy theorist on things, but here's something to think about, because it tells us and shows us the direction that things are going and how easy people will buy into this sort of thing. You are very well aware of the fact that even now, It is extremely easy to have all of your payment information set up on your phone. Some of you have that. I'm not telling you that you're doing something wrong by having that. You have touchless pay options with your credit cards, with your cell phones, with your Apple Watch, Taylor. You have the opportunity to be able to do that sort of thing. And so here you can do that. And boy, people buy into it because now everything that is needed is right there, convenient, in one place. You don't leave home without your phone. You've got it with you. You've got all of your medical history, everything that you need right there at your fingertips. You can now even put all of your travel passes, all of your airplane tickets, all of your hotel information. You can check into your hotels that now have the key card entry. You just have all that on your watch, Brother Chris. You walk up and you swipe your watch over your hotel door and you get in. Boy, it's convenient. It's easy. And the next step, and it's already being done in some regards, the next step is to have all of that information simply implanted under your skin. And it's being done. You say, well, Pastor, I'm not sure that I buy into the fact that it's being done. Time out. I wonder how many of you might have even GPS chips that have been inserted in your pets so that you'll know where they are if they get out and get away from you. It's easy. It's being done. Now listen, I know what some of you are thinking because I sat in churches 40 years ago, heard pastors preach about this sort of thing, and I sat there going, yeah, right, sure. But folks, not only is the technology available now to make it happen, the attitude is present with people that this is just a convenience for us now. It shows us how things are lining up and how it is that people will be able to buy or sell. And now look with me, Revelation 13, verse number 18, where the Word of God says, here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. This special mark is the name or number of the beast. It is the mystical 666. Now again, some of you have experienced this on occasions. You have walked up to the counter at McDonald's. You have ordered your quarter pounder with cheese, your large Coke, your large fries, and it's come up and your total is $6.66, and you're like, would you throw an apple pie on that too? Because I don't want to be spending $6.66. Now, probably no other number in Scripture has been as studied and maybe even as misapplied as the number 666. In the ancient world, the letters of the alphabet were also used for numbers, both in Greek and Hebrew. You had an alphanumeric system, or at times a code, an alphanumeric code. And Bible students have been attempting for years to unravel the mystery of this name and this number. Again, people have looked at the number and trying to come out with what is the name of this person and who it is. And if you work hard enough at it, almost any name will fit. You work hard enough. I thought about really just taking somebody's address from church tonight and plugging it in and beginning to do all of these different calculations between your home address and your zip code and your telephone number and all of this, and come out to the fact that it all adds up to be 666. If you add and subtract and multiply and divide and do this and do that, and there it is. You work hard enough at it, almost any name will fit. But here's something that I've got to point out. Since man was created on the sixth day, six is the number of man. Creation was made for man, and likewise the number six stamped on it. 24 hours to a day. 24 is 4 times 6. 12 months to a year. 2 times 6. Do you see how easy it is to manipulate even some of the numbers? 7 is the number of perfection. 7 is the number of fullness. But 6 is the human number. Just one short of perfection. Despite all man's imaginative calculations, we must confess that no one knows the meaning of this number and name. No doubt believers on earth at that time will understand it clearly, and the satanic trinity cannot claim the number seven. So what does it do? It claims and settles for the number 666. This much is sure, and I've already pointed this out in some regards. In recent years, we have seen a worldwide increase in the use of numbers for identification. Yes? Worldwide increase. You are no longer a name, you are a number. And so, almost 100 years ago, when Social Security numbers were first suggested and first began being distributed to people and assigned to people, even then, you had some people saying, oh, there it is. That's the mark of the beast. That's the number of the beast. Again, I'm not convinced that your Social Security number is going to, some of you are sitting here now adding it up and trying to figure, does that come? No, okay. I'm not convinced that your Social Security number is the mark of the beast, but all I'm saying is that slowly and steadily we get used to this type of identification, this type of keeping track of things. In fact, numbers are more important to computers than names are. Perhaps this is an advance warning of what will happen on earth when the beast is in control. We've reached the middle of the tribulation in our study, but we are not yet ready for the return of the Lord to the earth. Before John revealed how this glorious drama will climax, he paused to overview great events to come. And that will be part of our next topic when we come back to the study of Revelation. This much is clear in what we have seen from our study recently. An anti-Christian system pervades our world already. An anti-Christian system is already in place and is operating with full efficiency of this type of machinery. And true believers must not be a part of it, no matter the time in which they may live. We must shun false worship. Just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we must shun false worship. So lest you think that I'm trying to just cobble some things together, look with me at 1 Corinthians 10, starting at verse 14, the last section of verses that's on your study guide and that will be on the screens tonight. Look at these words. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak as to wise men, judge ye what I say. The cup of blessing which we blessed, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. Behold, Israel, after the flesh, are not they which eat of the sacrifices partakers of the altar? And then this is where I want us to focus tonight. What say I then? That the idol is anything, or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything? But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils. Do we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than He? Paul would ask. So it brings me to a couple of questions, a couple of thoughts to share with you in closing tonight. Just why are we to flee from idolatry? Why are we to shun false worship? Here's the answer for you. That we may be found faithful to the Lord in these last days. Just like the three men after whom we studied this morning. Our obedience to the Lord. Our obedience. Let me quickly do this. Our obedience is not what saves us. It's not what keeps us saved. Okay? The grace of God is what saved us. Your obedience to listen to His voice, yes, that saved you. But our obedience is not what saves us or what keeps us saved, but our obedience to the Lord, to His Word, to the Holy Spirit, it gives evidence to those around us that we are saved. It shows a lost and dying world that we have named the name of Christ and that following Him is important to us. Your testimony matters. And as a world looks at you, they need to see that there is indeed something different. That you are not engaged in false worship. That you're not engaged in idolatry. That you are worshiping the true God and following Him. One verse with which I will leave you tonight simply states from 2 Timothy 2, verse 7, consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things.